We'll continue in our series, the Epistle of Paul to the Ephesians, or the church at Ephesus. We're looking at his epistle, dealing with the doctrine of salvation, both individual and corporate. And we've subtitled this series, "The Unity That Believers Have in Christ Brings Unity in the Church, Which is the Body of Christ." This is sermon number 146, and we're dealing with Ephesians 6, 1 through 3. This Lord's Day, we will add verse 4 to our section, and we've entitled this section, "The Duty of Parents and Their Children in Christ's Church and Within the Family." And this is the fourth sermon in this section of our text. If you will, Ephesians chapter 6, verses 1 through 3. "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with you, and you may live long on the earth." Now, we've already looked at verses 1 and 2. We have a command that is a positive command given to children with a promise. Children, obey your parents in the Lord. That phrase, "in the Lord," means according to the revelation of God's word. That which is not sinful when command is given, you are to obey. You obey in the Lord. You are not expected to obey outside of the will of God, outside of that will as it is revealed in the written word. But it is a command clearly given to the children of the church. Now, it's a command given to the children of the church. The children have to be members of the church in order to do that. That is why we baptize our children. They are covenant members of the visible church of Jesus Christ. We do not know at what point in time that God may call them to himself, or he may never call them to himself. We do not know who the elect are, except by their profession of faith and life that they live according to the commandment of the Holy Scripture. But we know from the teaching of the Old Testament, as it transcends itself into the New, that the church of Jesus Christ, which was established all the way back with Adam and Eve, has continued in its various phases, with its different faces, if you will. And it has now continued in the fulfillment of the work of Christ. It's a church that does not come to an end. It continues. It is that root that has taken place, that has grown up. It blossoms into the tree. That root can be traced all the way back to our first great parents, Adam and Eve, for which God called them out of their sin and transgression into a relationship with him. There has always been both a spiritual, true church and a visible representation of that church upon the earth. As a matter of fact, theologically, we speak of this concerning the universal, invisible church. That is those who are made up, the elect of God, chosen before the foundation of the world. All men throughout history, from the beginning of creation to the final consummation of history. Then there is the visible universal church, that church which manifests itself on the earth, all over the earth. And then there is that church which is seen in a particular area, or as we would call them, a particular congregation. No one is added to the church universal, invisible, but those who are the elect. But to those who are on the earth, when salvation comes to them at the direction of God's hand, to those who are called the elect of God, They, along with their children, are identified in the body of Christ, the church visible. Does it mean the children are saved? But it means that they are to be seen as a part. The essential, most basic premise of the church is the family. Out of the family comes the church. Out of the family comes the state. Both state and church depended upon the family. Therefore, neither has the family ceased its existence, nor has God redefined it as anything other than the family itself, and nor has the church. The church under the Old Testament had various representations outwardly of things because Christ had yet not been revealed as to who the Messianic Savior would be, having though now been fulfilled, revealed through the power of the Spirit, wherein He hath entered the Holy of Holies once and for all time. Now the church is blossoming and building, as it were. It is coming into its fullness and the completion of all that God intended it to be. But it differs nothing from the Old Testament as to substance of salvation. There is no such thing as any salvation offered in a synthetic approach to justification. Justification by faith has always been God's plan of redemption through Jesus Christ. Whether you are looking forward to that application of the atonement, or whether we are looking back at that application of the atonement that has been given, shed, and applied. It has always been salvation by grace alone, through faith alone, through Christ alone, not of man. And so it is. Children have this responsibility, and Paul's addressing them and saying to them, you too have a role in the church, just as you have a role in the family. And the role you have within the church is still under the authority of your parents. That hath not changed. But Paul was able to address them directly as a part of the church, to give them command and direction on how they ought to be living out their lives, because they are identified with the church of Jesus Christ. They too are to be taught the things of God. And so we've seen in verse 2, he says, honor your father and your mother. Honor is respect that is due to them. Out of that respect flows obedience. And the promise that is attached therein is that it will be both well with you, the way that you live your life, and we'll see that in just a few moments, and that you will live long on the earth. Your days will be many. Now, that's just a context of what we're dealing with in verse 3, and then moving on to verse 4. Normally, I would separate these out, but there was not enough time after the last sermon to finish the little part of it we had to look at in verse 3 and then move on into verse 4 this week totally by itself. So I want to be able to go back and do that. But we're looking at a text that deals with, in particular, the law of God. Here you see an application by the apostle of the law of God, that moral law, the Ten Commandments of God, that fifth commandment in particular being applied here. In the church. It is learned in the home, but he's giving it in the context of the church itself. Again, using the model that you have in marriage. We noted it was built on Exodus 20 and verse 12. Honor your father and mother that you may be long upon the land which the Lord your God is giving you. And then in Deuteronomy 5, in the reissuing of the law, verse 16, honor your father and your mother, as the Lord your God has commanded you, that your days may be long and that it may be well with you in the land which the Lord your God is giving to you. Clearly, the family, the structure, has been based upon the very principle of how God has established the family from the beginning. Family has not changed. Now, we live in a world where there is a lot of individualization being emphasized. Well, one cannot be saved because you're simply a member of a family. Salvation is individual. But there are corporate aspects of it. The Church of Jesus Christ as a whole have been redeemed individually by Christ as a whole body. So when God comes to deal with the family, he deals with them as a whole family, not just as individuals separated. Now, much of this emphasis has come as a result, I believe, in the 20th century in particular, based on a lot of existentialistic philosophy. Everything is subjective to the individual. Individualization is the emphasis. Paul doesn't ever draw that principle out apart from personal redemption. Yes, one must be born again. One must be justified by faith through that passive and active obedience of the will of God in Christ, his Son. And here in this context, he's still dealing with the corporate aspect, but looking at the various relationships of the individual to the whole. To the husband, love your wife. To the wife, be obedient to your husband. Now he turns to the children. And he carries it down one more step. Children, obey your parents in the Lord. This is right. And in this commandment, we see the basic structure of social order in our society. It begins with the home. It begins in the training of the children to be reared up as to understanding their duty and responsibility to a greater authority. And thus, the Westminster Divines, when they wrote our confession, they spoke of the greater and lesser individuals, those who have responsibility and authority, those who are under such responsibility and authority are to be obedient. But they also turn around and say, yet do not forget the duty and responsibility of those to whom much has been given, to whom much authority has been given. We do not use it to our advantage. And so it's very important that we understand as we come to this context, as we're finishing up verses 1 through 3 here, because this is important, because he's next going to move to the parents. He first addresses those under authority, then he addresses those who have the authority. Well, if you will, let us continue to look here at verses 1 through 3. And in particular, we're going to draw our attention to verse 3 and finish up where we left off last Lord's Day so that we can move on to verse 4. Here Paul says, that it may be well with you, and you may live long on the earth. This commandment, as we have noted, is that fifth commandment of Deuteronomy 5:16. The whole commandment, as it recorded, is very clear. Honor your father and your mother, as the Lord thy God commands thee. It is a command from God, not an option. Even if mother and father are not believers, if they give lawful command in the Lord, according to the will of God, according to the teaching of Scripture, you're bound to it. This is a created order by God. They will have to give an account for what they do not do right. But he doesn't give options to the children. He doesn't say, if your mother and father are believers. as the Lord thy God hath commanded thee, that thy days may be prolonged, that you may live long. I realize we live in such a perverse time period, and throughout history, I know there have probably been perverse mothers and fathers. Not just perverted, but crazy. Who don't have a love for their children. But by and large, in the order of things as God hath created it, there is a love among all parents that should be common. Perhaps perverted by sin, thus lost. But nevertheless, a love for their children, that their children will do greater than their parents. They provide for them. They give them the things they need in order that they might have a better life than their parents had. That they may live long upon the earth. Because in the wisdom that the parents convey to them, they teach them how to avoid those things which would truncate their life. And he goes on here in this command and says that it may go well with thee. That is, that you may prosper. Things may go along well. Prosperity doesn't mean necessarily a gaining of a wealth, but the success of living a good life is involved. And the lamb which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Now, the meaning here is simply this. That children would be more useful. And they should be joyful and virtuous if they obey their parents rather than if they disobey them. In the commandment as recorded in Exodus 20:12, the promise is that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Yes, it is a reference to the land given to Israel. But does it deny the promise that is given to us and to our children in the New Testament? Absolutely not. It is well with them. It will prolong their days. And that which they have inherited from their parents, they should dwell therein with great success. In contentment of their life. This reference to the promised land, the land of Canaan, the meaning is doubtless, it is that special providence, securing to those that who are clearly being obedient to their parents, that they shall dwell long on the face of the earth. Whether it be in the Old Testament and in the land of Canaan, or whether it be in the New Testament, where the kingdom of God has expanded from Israel to all the nations of the earth. Long life was regarded as one of the greatest blessings in the Old Testament. And this blessing was annexed to this fifth commandment of children obeying your parents in the Lord. The apostle here gives to the promise a more general form and says that obedience to parents was connected at all times with that promise of life. Long life, a blessing. It affords a longer space to prepare for eternity. It enables a man to be more prosperous and useful in his dealings in life. It furnishes a longer opportunity to the study of the works of God here upon the earth. It is not improper to desire long life, and we should make use of all the means in our power to lengthen the days of our lives. and to preserve and to protect our lives to the glory of God, that we might establish and expand His kingdom here upon the earth. For where the church preaches the word of the living God, the kingdom of God is being established. And we have that responsibility. It is still true that obedience to parents is conducive to the length of life. That those who are most obedient in early life, in all things being equal, have the best prospect of longevity in life. And this is the case simply because, first, obedient children are saved from the vices and crimes that naturally shorten life. Secondly, no parent will command his child to be a drunkard unless he's that perverted in his sins. A gambler, a spendthrift, a pirate, a murderer. These such crimes or vices, resulting in the most cases, have come from the disobedience of children to their parents and the upbringing that they were given, all which contribute to a shortened lifespan. And they who early commit them most often can be assured they're going to increase the opportunity of their chances being an early grave in their life. No child disobeys a parent can have any security. They will not fall victim to these vices and crimes, all those things that will beguile him, that will seem pleasing to him. The thing we forget in this life, sin, while it is ugly before God, and it ought to be seen in that light by us in relationship to God, God says is pleasurable to man. Do you understand that? Sin, if it was really, I mean really, a reproach to us, we just wouldn't commit it. But the problem is, sin is pleasurable. There are certain pleasures that are received when you commit sins. And if you're unrepentant as a child, and if you disobey your parents, there's something that, as it were, enrages that furnace of disobedience within you, that natural depravity. Excuse me. That natural depravity of life. And it literally flames the pleasure of it. There's a joy in committing it. Why did you do that? I don't know. I don't understand. Why would they do that? They don't understand it either. I don't know. I liked it. It's a true answer. If they didn't like it, they wouldn't have done it. Some things are a repulsion to us. But having done it once, and each every time thereafter, that repulsion is replaced with a thrill, with a pleasure. We have to be careful to never allow our children to think that sin isn't pleasurable. It is. That's why there is a temptation to it. It tempts us. It bids us to come. Participate. Disobey your parents. Disobey the commandment of God. Does it not go back to the garden? Well, what did God say about that tree and its fruit? Do you not know that in the day you eat thereof, it will do something for you that you cannot do? Disobedience to God will lead to you becoming God in your own life. You will be like God. What a thrill that is. Sin is pleasurable in disobedience to the parents. And when they begin to sin, when they're young and they are not corrected, and they're not put on that path of righteousness, not taught to understand the consequence of such things, you simply are preparing them for one of the worst lives that they can live. Because they will feed their depravity. They will feed that which they naturally are attracted to in their life. Obedience to parents is connected with the virtuous habits that are conducive to long life. It will make a child industrious. It'll make him temperate. He'll be sober in the way that he approaches life. It will lead him to restraint and govern his wild passions. It will lead him to form habits of self-government, which will in the future life that he lives save him from the snares of all those vices, crimes of sin that were brought about through temptation. Many a life is lost early simply because a child does not obey his parents. The war with winning your children to learn how to reason, to govern their life based upon the teaching of Holy Scripture, it's won early on. The Scripture says, train up a child in Proverbs in the way he should go. From the Hebrew, what it really is a reference to is train up a child in his covenant, the covenant God has given to you. I will be a God to you and to your children after you. And when he comes to old age, it is a poor translation of the Hebrew there. When he comes to the age of adulthood, the age of majority. Well, what does that mean, age of majority? Puberty. When he becomes no longer a child, but what we would call early adulthood, 13, 14, 15 years old, that time frame. When he comes to the age of majority, he will not know how to live any other way but the way that you trained him in the covenant. It sounds real good. Actually, it's been a verse that has been used by the Arminian fundamentalist. You hear it in the Baptist churches and the Pentecostal churches. Well, train your children, even if they are disobedient, even if they get caught up in the ways of the world, just remember this, before they get real old, God will save them. They'll eventually be called back into a relationship with God. Excuse me. But my friends, that's not what the text is teaching. That's a lie. It's a misinterpretation. What the writer in Proverbs is speaking about is when you train a child from their birth till they come to the age of majority, 12 and 13 years old, when they become that young adult, they're not children. They're young adults. This idea of children going on and growing up to being 18 and 21 and 40, it's not happening. The Scripture identifies them at the age of majority. By that time, you should have already trained them how to reason from the teaching of God's commandments, how to reason from all the things the Scripture has demonstrated and taught to us, conveying that to them. We use the shorter catechism for that very purpose. that they have a foundation and how to make decisions that are right, that demonstrate the wisdom of God, that demonstrate obedience to their parents. When they come to the age of majority, they will not know how to live their life any different than the way they've been raised. In other words, they'll live their life the way they've been raised to think. If you don't do it by 13 or 14, you're not going to see it accomplished. But by truly a great miracle of God's grace and redemption. But oh, the tragedy that they may have to go through before they get there. The promise, train up the child. Children, obey your parents. It is a commandment with promise that has been annexed. It is the first commandment given in the second table of the law. The first four commandments on how we deal with God in worshiping the true and the living God. The second table of the law with the second of the six commandments deals with how man ought to interrelate with man one to another. And the first commandment in that table is with a promise. All these things that God has commanded in the sixth, the seventh, the eighth, and the ninth, and the tenth commandment are hinged upon the children learning to be obedient in order to carry out these things with his fellow man. We, of course, believe in the providence of God. And we believe that God certainly wants us to be involved in training our children. That doesn't mean everybody who is a believer is going to have children that are elect. If you haven't read the ninth chapter of Romans, you ought to read it. Abraham had two sons. One was a believer and one was not. Isaac had two sons. One was a believer and one was not. Election cuts across family ties. But that's not your business. That's God's. He will call the elect from out of their sins into life with Christ. Your job is to be busy about what God has commanded you to do as a parent, and you as a children to obey them in the Lord to live long. Well, now he moves on to verse 4, and I want to move as quickly as possible here. And again, I may not be able to get through all of this considering the amount of time I have and the amount of stuff that I need to cover. But look at the way the Apostle Paul transitions himself from verse 3 to verse 4. And you, fathers. Now, if you like to substitute that, the word fathers there is talking to the heads of the family. Is he leaving out the mothers? No. You could just as simply translate it, and you, parents. But because the fathers are responsible for the decisions that have to be made in the home, it doesn't mean he makes them by himself. He is to have and consult with his wife. But the ultimate responsibility falls with him to obedient to God because he is the head of his home. And you, fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and the admonition of the Lord. These are the duties of parents in the church and as it applies to the home. Fathers are addressed, as I said, but the mothers are just as well being addressed in this command. The fathers have a responsibility. And by identifying the highest authority in the home, he identifies all authority that descends downward. Negatively considered, parents do not have any right to act as they please toward their children. There simply is nothing where God says, okay, they're yours, do what you want to do with them. No. You cannot. Children are a heritage from God. They belong to God. All of creation belongs to God. All of His creatures belong to Him. He may not save all of them, but they all belong to Him as the Creator. And He doesn't give people free rein to do whatever they please. That's the lie in the garden that led to original sin. They are responsible to God, who has placed fathers and mothers here in this context over the children. Now, they are bound to act in accordance to the Word and His Spirit leading them in that Word. Parents provoke their children to wrath when they give them a sense of wrong. Parents do not have a right to demand of their children those things which are permitted and required by Scripture. They have to do what is right. They are permitted only to do what is right. They cannot do as they please. Do what is commanded of you in your role, father, mother, parents to your children. There are limitations to what is required of the children. And that's the context of him saying, don't provoke your children. Don't go beyond. Thus, to heap command upon command, prohibition upon prohibition, is not to accomplish the end aimed at with the rearing of children in the Lord. Our goal is not to so bind them up, bind them down. They simply become overwhelmed and they give up. When the requirement is more than can be reasonably rendered by the child. You ask a child to do more than what the child can do, you're going to provoke the child to anger, to wrath. You're going to invoke him to disobedience because it becomes irritating to him. He's being asked to do more than he can do. And I give you an example, and I think I've used it before. Phyllis and I were eating in a restaurant. Young family was in there. Had a little boy, told him, sit in his chair, be quiet. And he did that. Probably about 3 years old. But he was turning and looking all over the place. I mean, he wasn't just eating. He was getting a piece of food, and then he was looking around. He would wave when the steward, our waitresses, would go by. But he wasn't bothering anybody. He wasn't screaming. He wasn't talking. He was just watching. And the father said, don't do that. Turn around and eat your food. Well, he was eating it. Maybe not like the father would eat it, but he was eating it nonetheless. And you know how it is. When you're in a new place, you tend to want to know what's going on around you. You want to see what's happening. It happens even with adults in a restaurant. They can be eating and staring at everybody else in the place, watching what's going on, hearing things being said, loud, soft. It draws your attention away. He finally got up, took him out, and spanked him. His expectation was beyond what a three-year-old could do. I wanted to take the father out then and spank him. Because he's not smart enough not to heap upon his child that which he could not reasonably expect him to do. He did do the basic requirement. He was quiet. And he was eating at his food. Do not provoke your children to wrath. Children lose their sense of ability to obey. When under compulsion, they are provoked to wrath. And I'm not saying give a place for them to disobey. But if you create the avenue in which they cannot fulfill the expectation, and whether they do anything else, they are automatically put in that situation where they are in disobedience, you're pushing them to that end. And that is not wise. That violates the teaching of this text. It's true that children need a great amount of encouragement. They need direction, unequivocally. And it must be combined with expectation, but also with instruction. But within the reality of their ability to perform. There are some children, they just are easy. Say something and they do it. There are others, they're not so easy to work with. Some of them are easier to grasp concepts, some are not. Parents have to be wise and smart enough to do that very thing. And it falls to the fathers. I told you, this text isn't at any point. It doesn't exclude the mother, but the duty of the father is to make sure that the expectations are not beyond the child's ability. Children deserve encouragement for their seeking to fulfill their duties. Encouragement ought to be freely bestowed when they are meeting the expectations at the level they're able to perform. It's an encouragement to them. Sometimes performance, we've all been there, where we've worked hard to perform, but somebody's expectations are so far above our abilities, we can't perform at their level, at what they're expecting. It's beyond our reasonable ability to. But you can raise those expectations and abilities if you're patient and you give time and instruction and set the levels and slowly raise it up. But it takes wisdom to do that, does it not? And to bestow encouragement where it is not deserved is simply to encourage incongruity. Parents are to carefully consider the faults that are to be dealt with, but with great caution, seeking to understand the transgressions. Extreme care must be taken never to impute blame undeservedly or tentatively to children, ever. There should be no blame hinted at, even with a child, unless there is sure evidence that would support that allegation. What we are seeking to avoid in this case is to protect the children from forming a sense of injustice. We all live with that. You've gone through that in school, in your jobs. Nothing harder to deal with, is there, with a boss who always creates a sense in which you simply are being treated unjustly because they don't handle things properly, or they don't know how to manage people, or they don't know how to train people to be able to fulfill the functions that are expected of them. We don't want them to form a sense of injustice, provoke them to wrath. And one of the great results of that, in a child's mind, and I think most of you can probably identify with this, who were children at one time, think, well, if you want to blame me for that, then I might as well go ahead and do it. That's good humanistic reasoning, isn't it? I didn't do it. You blame me. There's no proof that I did it. I'm telling you I didn't do it. But if you want to blame me unjustly, then I might as well, if I'm going to get blamed and punished, I might as well do it. At least I get the pleasure of doing it. That's provoking your children to wrath, to anger, to rebellion. Being a parent is a hard job. I wish we all could do it so well. But in the midst of all of our trials, tribulations, crises, things that we deal with as adults, the reality is, it makes it harder to spend that time we need to give to our children. And are we not modeling our life the way we live and respond to those who are over us as a means of how our children respond to us? Boy, is it a hard job to be a parent. Children can understand an eruption of outrage for some serious offense. But not for a non-serious offense. They are quick to understand when their parents lose command. That's one of the great problems. Parents lose command of themselves, and their anger and their punishment is beyond what the offense itself bears. Now we've created an avenue by which our children are going to be provoked to wrath. This needs to be carefully avoided. For passion provokes passion. Therefore, a passionate father or mother can make a very passionate son or daughter. But when they become impassioned and they don't handle it rightfully, they've created a problem that is not according to Scripture. Parents' encouragement must be nurturing in both. Chastening and admonishing in the Lord. Parents have their children's physical development to carefully watch over, to ensure that they are developing their own intelligence. There is a duty to understand that their child is growing in intellectual ability. Matter of fact, we are not allowed to stunt their rational development. Scripture demands of us to be reasonable people. Come, let us reason together, says the Lord. Care must be given to our children, especially concerning their spirituality. This nurture is, of course, to have a distinctively Christian character. The application of these things mentioned are to be used toward the children's training to help grow them up to being believing adults. Parents are to train up their children as those who are committed to the care of the Church of Jesus Christ. They are to train them up for Christ. They are to instruct them with biblical truth. Parents are to attach their children not merely to themselves, but rather through Christ to themselves. Children are strive toward their being able to subject themselves to and be centered in Jesus Christ. The useful and important employments of children rearing are these. First, the use of chastening correctly. That is, children are, in a general way, to be able to distinguish their discipline by discipline that is reasonable rather than discipline that is used as a power structure in their life. Why do I have to do that? Because I said so is not a good answer. You need to reason with them. Here's why you have to do this. This is what God says in the Scripture. Now, I realize that's going to take time. And if there's one thing parents don't want after a day of work is a lot of time being taken up explaining to the children why they... It's just easier to say, because I said so. What do you want for dinner? I don't know. Just fix something. You choose. No, you choose. You know how that goes around the family. All over. Why? We don't want to deal with it anymore. We've had enough for the whole day. We're tired. We don't want to deal. Those things cannot be applied to our children. There is a rational limitation that must be used in the training and discipline and chastising of our children. The word chastising is more than just discipline by punishment. The punishment is actually accidental, or what is only occasionally to be resorted to in that way. There is always a consequence. It may not be a paddling. Not to say that paddling is not good, it is. But some offenses are serious enough to warrant paddling, some are not. Parents need to have wisdom in dealing with that. All of it. All of it is to be training. It's to be coaching. It's to be teaching. It's to encourage the children. And all that training and coaching and teaching that goes on is to the benefit of the child, in which he is able to learn how to please his parents in the Lord. He sees it. He understands it. He understands the rationale for it. He understands that consequences come from poor choices. But all choices have consequences. Some for good, and then those that are not so good or evil. The parent has certain rules by which they must train their children. And they have been given the power to enforce those rules. That's unequivocal. Yes, you are right in one thing. Because I said so. God gave me the authority. But you need to make that. It's not because I said so. It's because God said so. Look at the Word. Well, maybe you haven't trained them enough in the Bible. Maybe that should be the question. Well, you answer me. Why should you do this? What does the Bible say? You know what? We've covered this. Let's go over it again. The first lesson the parent must teach their children is that they have been given the authority and responsibility to train up the child. It's God-given. I can't rescind it. I can't say, okay, God, I'm done. This is it. No, He doesn't ever tell me there's a time I can quit my duty of training the child. Second lesson that a parent needs to learn is that all their assistance or resistance is in vain. All their resistance to that which they are called is in vain before God. Third, as soon as they can speak words, that is, of the children, they must use them. They need to use them in teaching, in getting responses from them, but more than anything else, teach them to use those words in prayer before God. It is so important that the children learn to repent in prayer and seek out God, seek out His help, that they can be an obedient child to their parents, to do what's right, to have wisdom in how to apply the things they're being taught. Children need to be taught to pray for their meal, because all such bounty comes from God, and we are commanded to give thanks unto Him for it. Fifth, parents need to make complete their lessons. That is, all the studies the child is given a responsibility, his education, the development of his intelligence. That the child may know that they have got to work and not be idle in their life. They're not here to play. Playing is a benefit you get for being good. But your responsibility is to be educated. You're a student. That's your vocation. You're not old enough to work yet. You can't make enough wise decisions for somebody to want to pay you money when you're 5 years old. Well, there's a few child prodigies that may not be true for, but they're one in a billion. What's your calling, children? To be educated. To be a student. To be trained by my parents, that when I stand before God, I make my choices with wisdom. They are all prudent. The consequences are good and their benefits to me. You need to train them that way. This is your job. This is your vocation. This is what you've been called to do. One day, you're going to be called, get out of the house and go to work. But till you are trained to that ability, your job is to be a student. One day, you'll get promoted to being an adult and a father or mother. And then all those things fall to you to reproduce what your parents were supposed to reproduce in you, and God willing, they have done that. Sixth, parents need to make the children to select as, to be selective, excuse me, as to their companions in order that they do not get involved in evil associations. You got to help them. You always have got to ask them, what would have been the right choice? Why don't you run around with Billy and Bobby down the street? Because Billy and Bobby run around and knocking out windows and stealing stuff, and it's not okay for them to be with you. You can't be with those kind of kids. They're terrible. They're violating the law of God. You got to teach them how to find and choose good companions in life, people to be friends with, people who will not be associated with evil, but rather righteousness. Seventh, we need to appoint certain hours for the duties of the house to be performed so that children can learn both punctuality and order that is to be given to their house. Excuse me. Eighth, the parent does not ask them if they will go to church. The parent going to church takes them to church with them. That's the responsibility. It's not an option. It never is an option. Well, I'm 10 years old now and I choose not to go to church. No, get your clothes on, you're going to church. There's no option here. I'm commanded to go. You're commanded to go. You're going. But if you choose not to go, then don't be surprised that they don't want to go. And they will learn not to go. This is the kind of training we're talking about. This is what it's meant here. Don't provoke your children to wrath. You've got these responsibilities. The children are to obey you. Your job is to teach them. But do it properly. Do not do it with an imbalance, with an unreasonableness, an unseasonable ability to make right choices, to put upon them duties and prohibitions. Don't so build them over that they feel as if they are completely tied up and shut down as an individual. Do not make expectations that are on way beyond their level of ability. It can't be done. In other words, don't be foolish in that. You can't take a five-year-old and give him a calculus book and say, do this for school today. You got to get him there. That would be an unreasonable expectation. Wow, guess what? So would a second grade math book. It's not expected. You know, I don't know why, but originally when they were giving out grades in schools, A was for that exceptional student. B was B of average. He's above average, but he's not so exceptional. C, this is where he's supposed to be functioning. This is normal. If he does this, C isn't bad. D, he's not up to the norm. He's slow. F, he's failing. He's not getting it. The grades all had a purpose. But in time, parents started to shift the emphasis. I don't want you to get C's. I want you to get A's and B's. And then it's all A's. And why don't you get A's? Well, if he comes home with all C's, he's normal. But they don't understand that. They don't see that way. It was a means by which the parents were to be advised on how the teacher saw their abilities and performances, where they were at, to know whether or not they were normal or if they were behind and needed help, or if they were exceptional or really ultra exceptional and advanced. But today, it's the expectation is what? You must get all A's. Doesn't happen. Why? Because it's more important for parents to be able to say, oh, my child has all A's and is on the honor roll at school. We've created all these things. And in rather using what these things were designed for, they've now become a status quo. And the status quo and the pride of the parent is that you need to perform beyond normal expectation. No, you may be gifted by God to do that, but let me tell you something. When the norm becomes A, the education has dropped down to get everybody there. I have a sixth grade McGuffey reader at the house that we taught Allison, and I think Alyssa read them too. A sixth grade McGuffey reader today is about a sophomore or junior college level reading book. Sixth grade. Do you think we have dropped down in our quality of education? We want to make all children on the honor roll. One day, well, in California, they were so good about it. Children used to be able to, if you can script your name, write out your name, spell it correctly, you graduated from high school. That was the expectation. They don't have that anymore. Just like Florida, if you attend, you'll get a certificate of attendance. You graduated from high school with a certificate of attendance. Education is no longer mandatory. The state got sued too many times. We're not going to teach your children. We're just going to tell you they got to go, and here's their certificate that says you get to stay out of jail. You weren't truant. Have the expectations dropped? Of course they have. We're expecting our children to do things that God himself does not put upon them unless he gives them to that ability. College was never designed for every child. Vocational skills were given. Some had college abilities, but few did. Most jobs didn't require them. most jobs required you to be vocationally trained correctly. But then everybody has to have a bachelor's degree. Guess what? A bachelor's degree gets you about nothing. Now you almost have to have the master's in most fields. Because the bachelor's degree really doesn't mean a lot. Because they've had to dumb them down. You have to do something because you got to get all these football players that can't put two words together in an interview. You got to get them passed. My favorite ones were back in the old days when I was growing up. I always loved Rose Bowl Day because it was either the University of California or USC who was leading the way in education on the California coast. And the guys would run up and they would say, my name's such and such, I'm a junior, my major is... Now, if you knew anything about Ohio State, getting an education was the main part of you getting a scholarship. You didn't get your grades and get your degree, you were off the team. But not all coaches were that way, and not all schools were wanting to put those requirements on. So you would get the kids from California run up and go, my name's such and such, I'm a junior, and my major is basket weaving. My major is underwater basket weaving. My major is flying. You don't think so? Go back and look and see what kind of classes they were taking. The ones I loved was the guys who sputtered around and said, my major is speech therapy. I don't get it. That would make Sylvester the Putty Cat excellent in speech therapy. I mean, it just makes no sense. What is going on? The dumbing down of education to children. The drop of expectations. And that can be a problem. As much as putting too much on at the wrong time, also not putting enough upon them in their expectation. We've lost our sense and purpose of why God created us. Because we've become nothing but a humanistic society. I'm telling you, it's so important that we understand our term and understanding of what it means to train children, to admonish them, to instruct them. We have got to understand what God has given to us. Some things we need then to avoid. First, avoid overprotection. The parents have a propensity to fear that harm may befall their children and fence them in from every direction. You can't completely protect a child from everything. That is an impossibility. But you need to be able to understand what things are truly needed to be protected against. Why? Why is that important? Because children need to be able to also survive and have a sense and an ability of confidence that they can live the way God has commanded them to live. You have to be very careful. We need to avoid favoritism within the home. We need to avoid discouragement being created by the parents in the home. We need to teach children how to make good decisions, not make them for them. You make decisions for your child as they get older. You do that for a reason. It's because you're going to trump their decision. You don't make the decision. You tell them, you make the decision here. Show me you can make the right decision. Now, I may have to say to you, nope, you're not. That's not the right decision, and here's why. So you're not going to do that. But you need to teach them quickly how to start making decisions so that they will go through life and have a standard by which their decisions can be made and made right and justly before God. Avoid neglecting the children. It's an easy thing to do to want to cater to our needs. But we cannot put our needs above the children's needs. They cannot be neglected, avoided. You cannot put their problems aside. They are your problems. Avoid bitter words and avoid physical abuse. You don't want to provoke your children to anger, to wrath. You want to provoke him to do what's right. You want him to see why he ought to be obeying his parents and the Lord. Do it with joy. His delight to see his parents pleased with the way that he handles his life. This is important. Now, in itself, all of this is not just Paul going, let's talk about the family. He has application for this that he's going to talk about later on. But in this is that principle. Parent to child. Child to parent. The greater ruler, the lesser. Those who are responsible, how to respond to those who have authority. Those who have authority, how to use their authority wisely. Just like in husband and wife. As Christ commands us and is our head and wisely tells us what we ought to do as husbands. Husbands then turn in their authority. That authority, not that it makes the wife less. She stands equally before God. He's got the head of the family responsibility. He is to teach her. She's to respond to him. They together to the children to them. There's that whole vertical relationship that's going on. And yet we are all, even our children, are all equal with us in Christ. You can never treat your children less than you would treat Christ. You can never treat your wife less than you would treat Christ. You can never treat your husband less than you would treat Christ. You can never treat your church member less than you can treat Christ. You can never put expectations upon people that they cannot fulfill. That's why the scripture says, do not lay your hands on anyone quickly in roles of leadership. Because the reality is maybe they can't meet the expectations and the demands of the office. We in life are faced with all of these lesser and greater authority structures. Responsibility to teach, to train, to direct, to command, to have authority over. Responsibility and how to respond to those things rightfully. Use wisdom in applying your authority. Be wise in how to obey those who have rule over you. Where is that the greatest structure in teaching of that? Where can you teach a child better than any place else how to live a proper, socially developed life? It is in the home. Because if you learn how to live rightly in the home, you can do it anywhere else. You can do it in the church. You can do it in the civil magistrate. You can do it in the society at large. You have been trained in the exact best framed environment that God could have created you in. If not, he'd have let the church somehow create people. Or the state to create people. You know what neither one of those do? They don't create people. They're not the training ground. It's the home. And Paul's reminding the church of all these duties that he's talked about. Think about all that we've been dealing with. Chapter 4, chapter 5, Paul says, this principle comes in learning those things, they come from your youth up. Do not forget where the family is in these things. It is the basis for everything social and structured in our society. Here's where the child learns character, demeanor, how to conduct himself in public as well as private, as well as interacting with other individuals. The family does not take that does not take time to teach, to train their children in the things of the Lord and His Word, will not turn out children of the living God, but pagans, little heathen. That's all they're going to be. Children, note well, you were addressed first. It belongs to you to obey your parents out of reverence to God. Why should you do what they said? Real easy. God gave you parents to direct your life. You are obeying God through obeying them in the Lord in all things lawful. Parents, note carefully your responsibilities the Apostle Paul has laid out for the family. We have a great amount of duty and responsibility. And the Apostle Paul hath not left a stone, literally, in principle, unturned. You want a great church? You got to learn structure and authority. You do it between those who are leaders in the church and those who are there as members. You learn it from the home. Husbands properly loving their wives. Wives respecting their husbands. Children obeying their parents. Parents being responsible to train wisely and not provoke their children to wrath. When you understand these structures, you have a great church, you can have a great society. You can live at peace with all men. But without it, it's not going to happen. We have a great responsibility and duty as parents before God. And He doesn't give us any relief from it. Oh, the day will come when they leave home. And as you grow older, you will have your regrets. I wish I'd have been better. I wish I'd have been more consistent. I wish I'd a million things. God expects you to do to your ability what you can do. These are His commandments. He demands perfection from us. But in His grace, He has given us Christ. And even in those commands and expectations, He has mercy toward us in our shortcomings. We need discipline. We need strength. We need authority. We need grace. We need mercy. We need love. For love, as the Apostle says, can hide a multitude of sins. And we got plenty of those to go around. Consider your responsibilities. Think carefully. Let your children be trophies of what you have done in rearing them before the public. When they see them and they note how that they're so different than the world. They're different from the children who are in the public school. Well, of course they are. We had a duty and responsibility. These are our children. These are given us. These, God has given them to us to raise them for His glory and honor. Not to raise them for our glory and honor, to raise them for His glory and honor. Never forget, children, that's why your parents are who they are. And you better be thankful for them. For they care for your soul. And they care for your life. And God has put a promise to you that if you will honor them and obey them, you will live a good life before Him. It may not be as a millionaire. It may not be with a huge prosperity, but you will live at peace and contentment knowing that you're right with God and you're doing the things that God has required of you. So let it be said of us that we seek to fulfill all these relationships rightly. It's easy for us to fail. We need to help one another, encourage one another, not discourage, encourage. Not go beyond the expectations, meet the expectations where the person is at, but let's help raise them up in their expectations that they are able to do far more than they think they're able to do. May God help us to learn these principles. Paul has given us some wonderful things here. And we need to really consider how to implement them in a way that God would truly be glorified. May God help us do that. Shall we pray?